Hello, everybody. Bonjour. Looks like we're going to start. Thank you so much. It's great to see all the tables so full. Welcome, then, to the seventh edition of the AXA Pop Days. I'm Greg Foote. I'm a science presenter. I've worked with AXA for a number of years now. I'm a partner, and I also produce films and tell some of the stories of the AXA Research Fund. The AXA Research Fund Pop Days are always a very important day because they're an opportunity for the researchers to come and talk about their research. Over the past 2 days, we've been training them in ways to popularize their research. That's what POP stands for in Pop Days, okay? It's not pop music. They're not going to get up here and sing like it's expert. Well, some of them may. No. So that's what Pop Days stands for. And popularization skills are very, very important because to be able to engage the public in the debate about their research and to be able to take part in that conversation and then communicate their research is one of the key features and important points and key milestones in the AXA and AXA Research Fund brand. So, to kick off our session, I'm going to introduce somebody who I'm sure you all know who's going to come up and just say a couple of words and kick off the day. So I'd like to welcome Christian Timan, who is overseeing the AXA Research Fund. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Greg. It's a great pleasure for me to add my word of welcome to all of you. It's wonderful to have so many people from the research side here in our building and so many AXA colleagues around the table. You know, the research is something that touches not only our minds but also our emotions. Because when you work in an insurance company, you are in daily touch with many clients, with many firms, with many situations that involve risk and risk solutions. And we all are looking forward, and on this way of looking forward, we have many, many open questions. And at the moment, as you see, there is a lot of questions coming from research on the future treatment of life and health risks. There's even questions on the future of financial protection. There's questions about the climate and climate change. And on all of these questions, we are very much believing in research helping us to see better the future, to look farther into the future, and to better understand the solutions that we can provide then to people whom we hope that they will live better lives and more empowered lives, and also to firms that can thrive in an environment of greater security. So this is something where we are really trying to have the fund to bring in people, to help them to do their research and to increase, if you like, the synapses between AXA people and the researchers. Because what you are doing, you're looking much further perhaps into the future and you're finding many new ways perhaps to treat risks. And if we think of innovations, many innovations in our space are coming also from researchers that are indeed helping societies to understand the risks and finding solutions. So this is why we are very, very happy that you're here. We hope very much that you have enjoyed the days. Research is not just doing good things, it's also about communicating good things. And this is often also a difficult part in order to be able to speak about one's research, to present one's findings, to engage the audience. And this is something we hope to be able to help you that you will be able to disseminate your research in the most effective way. So this is my word of welcome to you. Great to see you all. You're part of the community. We would love to stay in touch with you. We are there also to help you in the period ahead. And please do use the opportunity to make connections with AXA. We have many, many questions, and we hope that you will help us to enlighten our path along the future. Thank you very much, and I wish you a great day. Thank you.
Okay, so for the past 2 days, the AXA postdocs, there are 16 of the Research Fund postdocs, have been undergoing public engagement training. And it's all been building to this next hour right now. They're going to be presenting their training in front of AXA people. This is hard. Some of them are nervous, understandably. So we need to all kind of make a decision that we're going to be very supportive and loving and give them big beaming smiles. So let's, before they've said a word, let's give them a round of applause and congratulate them. Okay. All right, so this is how it's going to work. I'm going to invite up the postdocs in groups of four. And what we're going to have is the first person to speak is going to take the podium and get ready and get psyched and get in the right frame of mind. The other three are going to sit on the chairs just here. Then they're going to come up one at a time and they're going to have 2.5 minutes to present their research to you. Then when all four have presented, I'm going to welcome all four up and I'm going to ask them one question for just a couple of minutes. They're not going to get off that easily. And then they're going to go and sit back down again. Now let me explain what you're going to see. They were challenged to present their research without any graphs, figures, photos, nothing. What we wanted to do was to recreate, as you all know, when you're having a coffee with somebody or when you're having lunch with somebody and you scribble down what your research is. That's what they've been doing. They've been scribbling it down on a paper placemat like this, or a set de table. It's about as good as my French gets. So what they've done is they've drawn on top of one of these, we've taken a photo of it, and that's what you're going to see behind them. So that's all they have to communicate their research. Now, we need all of you lot to get involved as well. On your table, you have some pieces of paper like this. What we'd like you to do is when you are listening and you are watching, we'd like you to write down the name of the person who's speaking at the top and then a couple of questions that you'd like to ask them. Those questions might be about how their research is going to impact society. It might be a question directly relating to AXA and insurance. It's up to you. Then later on, you're going to get a chance to come and sit with the researchers. You'll get about 5 minutes with each researcher, and you'll be able to ask them some of those questions and get some of those answers. So I think we're ready to go. Are we all set? We all good? Okay, all right. So the first four are all environmental risks. We are going to dive into the ocean with Aurelie. We're going to battle a monsoon with Ricardo. We're going to face a tsunami with Rebecca. And we're going to zoom into a fire with V. So, can you all join me, please? And Aurelie, I'm going to give you the podium to start off with. That's for you.
Yeah.
Okay, whenever you're ready, your 2.5 minutes starts when you start speaking.
Good morning, everyone. I am Aurelie, and the aim of my AXA work is to understand the role of the ocean on European weather extremes. So which extremes are we talking about? The one that you've probably experienced lately. I mean, floods, heat wave, hurricanes in the tropics, or an excessive amount of snow. And the problem is that with climate change, these extremes are expected to be more frequent and more intense. And they have huge impacts on the society, on finance, and on the economics. Like, for example, the 2003 heat wave led to 70,000 deaths in Europe, 15,000 deaths in France. So obviously, we care about that, and AXA care about that, because we want to be able to forecast them, to get prepared, and because we need to understand their origin. But can we do it now? Can we predict them? It depends. On daily timescales, we can. The meteo on TV every night is more or less okay. But as soon as we move on to season, years, decade, this is not reliable anymore. So, and the reason for that is that because we are only looking at the atmosphere, and this is not enough. The atmosphere is moving very fast. And we need to find in our system something that has memory, something that can hold an anomaly for a long time. And here, I'm talking about the ocean. And the ocean holds 1,000 more heat than the atmosphere. And then it will transport this heat from the equator to the north and to Europe. And what we do in our lab is we take as many measurements as we can of the oceans, so which are represented here. So this is just a very quick example of one of our latest results. So the ocean can transport more or less heat. And in winter 2009-10, we had a large amount of snow, if you remember, around here. And this was due to the ocean, which transported less heat. So if there is one thing you have to remember about what I said of my research, is that we can't ignore anymore the role of the ocean. And understanding it is key to be able to perform good or better seasonal forecast and to be able to get prepared to those high impact weather extremes. Thank you for your attention.
That was absolutely spot on 2.5 minutes. Well done. We'll just let the last couple of people sit down so we just all get settled. Ricardo is going to take to the podium and get ready. All good? Are we all happy? Good. All right. On to the next one. Over to you.
Okay. So I'm Ricardo, and I will talk about monsoon predictability. So is there any relationship between the rain and your car? This is a problem. The aim of my project is to understand if the presence of small particles in the atmosphere can affect the rainfalls. There are two magic words, India and aerosols. Aerosols is the word that we use for defining the small particles into the atmosphere, which can be pollution, sea salt, dust, or something like that. India, why India is important? It's because it is a very nice test case. Due to the recent industrialization and the population growth, it is a highly polluted area. And the second reason is because due to the monsoon seasonality, there are really clear and defined precipitation patterns. So, Indian economy is based on mainly on agriculture, and agriculture relies on the water resources availability. In regular condition, we have the sun. Oops, sorry. We have the sun, which heats and warms up the ocean and the land in India. And what happens is that the water evaporates and creates the rain, and the rain is homogeneously redistributed into the land. But it looks like, due to the presence of the aerosols and your cars, the radiation coming from the sun is reflected by these particles, and it doesn't reach the ground. So this means that the ground cools down, the water does not evaporate on that area, and all the rain are shifted in the northward, in the northern part of India. So what I'm doing with my project is, for the first time, using real measurements for understanding what's happening there. Because so far, just models were used for that. And by using satellites measurements, it will be possible also to link the results to the future development. So there are two risks in this area. The drought in the southern part of India, which means that about 50% of the territory would be lacking of water resources, and floodings in the northern part of India. So is this truly a risk? The question is still open, and this is what I'm investigating. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You can take a seat. We will swap you with our next speaker. Rebecca? All right. Good artistic work there on the placemat, by the way. Liked the snowy mountaintop. Okay, Rebecca, all happy?
Yeah.
Over to you.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. My name is Rebecca, and I'm talking about my AXA project now. Probably most of you remember the 2004 earthquake that happened around Christmas at the island of Sumatra, which generated a large tsunami on the Indian Ocean, and more than about 280,000 people died during the tsunami and earthquake. Other well-known earthquake is the Japan earthquake from 2011, which also killed nearly 20,000 people along the coast of the Pacific Ocean. This earthquake is also well-known for the catastrophe of the nuclear power plant at Fukushima. These earthquakes happen in the Indian Ocean, Pacific Ocean. But what about the Atlantic Ocean? Can this happen here? This could be there an earthquake or tsunami in the Atlantic Ocean that could threaten the European or North American coast? One area to look at is Greenland. Greenland is covered by a lot of ice, and the ice is melting because of the climate change. The probably most well-known effect of this melting is a change in sea level. The sea level around the coast are rising because of the ice sheet melting. In my AXA Research Fund project, I'm now developing a new model which will be able to explain sea level change and Earth deformation and links this to earthquakes. And this will be the first model ever done for any place around the world. And hopefully, by the end of the project, I will be able to then identify areas in Greenland which are affected by melting and have earthquakes. And if these earthquakes happen off the coast, we might generate tsunamis which will threaten the North American coast or the coast in Europe, and also affect a lot of people might be dying along the coast, or even nuclear power plants that will be flooded by the water from the ocean. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Rebecca. I will swap you with our final speaker of the group of four, Vila. I'll just ask if all of our speakers can ensure they stay just behind the podium, because we need the microphones to pick you up for the cameras. But lovely projection to the whole audience. Right, are you all set?
Yes.
Great stuff, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ville Vakkari, and I'm interested in forest fires. I think they are fascinating, especially because they emit so much smoke into the atmosphere. And this smoke is actually one of the largest sources of small particles into the atmosphere. These particles are not healthy. It's been estimated that just inhaling this smoke kills about 300,000 people per year. Now, in addition to health, these particles also affect our climate. Some of them are soot, which means that they are black. They absorb solar radiation, and that means that they are heating up the atmosphere. The non-soot particles tend to be quite bright and shiny, which means that they are reflecting sunlight, and then they cool down the atmosphere. So in the smoke, it's kind of fighting between the soot particles, the black particles, and the bright particles. And it seems that the bright side is winning by a narrow margin with a very large uncertainty, which means that this is one of the largest sources of uncertainty in our understanding of the climate at the moment. Now, what I found out is that in just about 3 hours after the fire, there is twice as many particles on average in the smoke. And this depends in a quite a complicated way on what was burning. Was it forest? Was it savanna, grassland, cropland, something else? And then it depends on how it was burning. Was it flaming nicely, smoldering? And also what was going on in the atmosphere? Was there solar radiation to kick some chemical reactions into go? Was there turbulence to mix it well? And what I'm working on at the moment is I'm trying to simplify this into something that would be so simple that we can include it in quite coarse global models. And then we would have a better idea on how the climate is going to evolve. We would have a little bit less uncertain climate predictions. And also we would get a better forecast for the health effects. So for instance, we could get a forecast that tomorrow from 3 to 6 p.m. it's going to be so unhealthy that you had better be just holding your breath for that moment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, you can stay up here if the other three speakers could come and join us as well. If you could make a very small... Stay with me, Aurélie. Thank you. If you can make a nice arc around the podium a bit further in, that'd be great. Okay, so here is my question to you. It's very clear with all four of your research that the impact on society could be huge, okay? Whether that's climate change with the heat being absorbed by the ocean, or whether that's being seen through the forest fires or the earthquakes. So my question is more the relation to insurance, okay? So what do you think the impact of your research could be on AXA Insurance? Who would like to answer the question?
I think in my case it's pretty simple. Is if we are able to improve the weather forecast, then we'll be able to get prepared. So
short and sweet. You've had some great training. Would anybody else like to suggest how their research could immediately benefit and influence AXA Insurance?
I think it's coming more or less indirectly, so that the society as a whole is better prepared for future changes. And that means that there is fewer risks will really realize. And that will then benefit also the insurance company, I think.
Thank you very much. I only have 1 minute with you all. That is pretty much my minute. So let's give them a huge round of applause as they go back to their seats. Thank you very much. Okay, so that's group one done. I'll now switch back to this microphone. So group two now is all about life risks. They're up already, look at them. Gosh, they're on it. So Roman is going to introduce us to armoured bacteria. Lorenzo is going to introduce us to new nanomaterials. Romain is tackling outbreaks of disease, and Nadia is researching HIV. So we're in for a bit of a roll for the next 10 minutes. Roman, are you all set?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Over to you.
Well, good morning, action people. My name is Romain Thibault, so I am from New Caledonia, and I'm working there as well. I'm working in life science at the Pasteur Institute. Actually, I did more than 10,000 kilometers to be here today, and what I want you to do is to come back into a journey back in New Caledonia with me for the next 3 minutes, let's say. Okay, so just imagine that you are in New Caledonia under the tropics. Just get rid of the 24-hour flight and the 10-hour jet lag. We don't need that. But, you know, the sun is shining, blue water, blue skies, white sand, nice girl. Oh, I should not have said that, sorry. And so you may think that this is paradise on the earth, and you probably are right. But actually, there is a dark side. Sorry. And the dark side of this picture is everywhere in New Caledonia, there is a deadly bacteria, which is called Leptospira. It's a funny, curly bacteria. And this is a waterborne pathogen, which is, and the dissemination of this bacteria is strongly linked to the climate changes. And I grew up in New Caledonia, and I always remember my parents saying, Romain, you should not go in fresh water. Romain, don't walk on barefoot. Romain, don't do this, Romain, don't do that. So it was really boring. And I was remember when I was young, how we can live in such beautiful country, but without to be able to fully enjoy the country. So it was so frustrating. But thanks to my boring parents, and thanks to the support of AXA, I can now have an input on this disease. And so during my work, I address a single question, which is how this bacteria can survive in the environment. Because this bacteria should not be able to survive into the environment because, you know, it's really stressful for bacteria. But this bacteria developed a particular protection, which is called biofilm. It's kind of a shield that protects the bacteria. So this is really smart, but we can outsmart this bacteria. And this is what I do in the lab. So I use a microscope, I look to these structures, and I try to understand this composition. What are the structural features of this biofilm? What is the morphology? Is there any patterns that we can use to get more information? Because behind that, the more you have information of your enemy, and the better you can fight it. And I hope I will be able to disrupt this protecting structure very soon. So this is the end of the journey. I hope I not frighten you. But be sure that me working there, supported by the AXA Research Fund, this will be an old story in a few years. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Okay, I'm going to swap you with Lorenzo is next. This is for you. Okay, Lorenzo, you're set?
Sure.
Over to you.
Thank you, Greg. I'm Lorenzo from Barcelona, and I will talk to you today about viral pandemics. So something we all heard about it. Today in the news, we heard about Zika. Last year was about Ebola. In the previous years, we heard about avian flu, swine flu, since every year there's a more fashionable virus. And unfortunately, we all know it's a severe threat for human health. And what you see here is one of the bad guys. It's a structure of influenza virus. You see the genome in the center is closed in a box called envelope, and on the outside are these proteins that want to infect your cells. They're way too entry in the cells. And all this is packed in a very, very small size. The size of this object is around 100 nanometers, so it's 100 billionth of meter. So extremely small. And why these are so dangerous? Because they have a high ability to mutate. So they change continuously, and it can happen that a new strain appears that is more aggressive and can escape our drugs, our treatments. And this spread quickly and create a pandemic event. That's why they're so dangerous. This is exactly what we want to tackle. We want to have a new approach in my AXA project that can tackle this issue using nanotechnology. So the virus is small, we can build some small object too, using nanotechnology. In particular, what you're building is very small fibers, about the same size as the virus, about 100 nanometer. I think Sophia called it the nanolazos. And this is the lazos that will catch the virus. So the idea is that our fibers will stick to the surface of the virus, coating it, wrapping it completely. And the wrapped virus is not infective anymore because all the proteins on the surface that mediate infectivity are now totally blocked. So we make a harmless virus that cannot be a threat anymore. And as we tackle the virus as a whole, and not in a specific protein point, this is less susceptible to mutation. So it's a universal approach to viral disease. So where are my project now? We finally produce our first nanofibers. We are in the store in my fridge in Barcelona, and we hopefully test it soon on some influenza strain. And hopefully in my next visit to Paris, I can talk about a successful universal treatment for viruses. And thank you for your attention.
Just loading up your Prezi.
Yep.
Batman power is over to you.
Hi everyone, I'm Romain, and I'm mostly work on viruses in wild animal populations. So the first thing I want to make a little list of things you might have heard about. So Andra, Nipah, SARS, MERS, Marburg. Yeah, sorry, that's an R, so it's placemat writing. And maybe the latest one, Lorenzo mentioned it, Ebola. So Ebola in West Africa, up to last year, was about 30,000 people infected, 10,000 plus people dead. So quite important, and it'd be important to be able to predict and be better prepared for those kind of outbreaks. But why did I make that whole list of scary things? Well, it's because they have one thing in common, and that one thing is not Batman, it's just the bats. Bats are actually infected with all those viruses, and they don't die, they don't show symptoms, and they actually remain infected with those viruses. And the one thing I am trying to understand during this AXA Research Fund supported project is, do we have periods of time when there is an increased risk? And we think that one important period for female bats is when they are giving birth. Why is that important? Well, there's one very specific constraint for a bat. When a woman's pregnant, she puts on weight, right? Bat can't do that because they need to keep flying. So they have to lose weight and to get into a very bad condition, which makes them more susceptible to virus infections. On top of that, all the births happen at the same time, meaning that we have lots of females potentially infected in a population at the same time, which increases the risk of what we call spillover. That means the virus going from the bat to the human. Why does that help us to be able to predict when spillover might happen? It's because that may help us mitigate the risk of those spillovers by saying that at those periods, maybe you should eat less bushmeat. So you might not realize it, but bats are very important food in some places. And the species I work on, for instance, is eaten in numbers that are over 100,000 per year. The other thing is, we might be able to be better prepared for when it may happen. The first few weeks of an outbreak are very crucial. So that's why it's very important to be able to better predict when the bats are infected. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pass it over. Oh, sure, okay. Oh, blimey. Are you all ready?
Yes.
Over to you.
So my name is Nadia, and I'm from Africa. I was born in 1986, and when I was born premature. The doctors told my mother I would have no hands, no legs, I would have no brain function. What they didn't know is that in 2016, I would be in Paris. So what am I doing now? I'm very passionate about prematurity. I moved to South Africa, thanks to AXA. I love the beaches in Cape Town. And there, I'm dealing with the number one cause of prematurity. My mother was healthy, but in South Africa, we have so many women who have HIV, and therefore they are at risk of getting their children premature, right? So what do? I go, I get a lady, she's HIV pregnant. I don't pick random women, they have to accept. Then she has to agree to come into the study. I get her at 5 months pregnant, because we don't want to miss the prematurity, right? And then she comes, I follow her up to make sure that if she gets the baby premature, I have to know what the problem is. After that, she gets her baby, so sad that it's often premature. I get the placenta. When I get the placenta, many of you know the placenta as the afterbirth. In Africa, their placenta is completely thrown away. But because of AXA, this is the first time that we're looking at the placenta. I look at the placenta, and there are specific cells that I'm looking for. Why am I looking at these cells, and why am I looking at HIV? These cells are called regulatory T cells in the lab. Outside the lab, I tell small children they're called the soldier cells. Why are they called the soldier cells? Because you're half your mom, you're half your dad, right? But when you're being carried in your mom's tummy, you can't be rejected. Your mom has to accept you, whether your body, you know, her body thinks that this is foreign. Who's this other half, right? So the soldier cells have to go up so that you ensure that your body, her body doesn't reject the baby. But HIV comes and causes total confusion. It kills all those soldier cells. So the body is so happy to reject that baby, and then the baby comes out early. This has to stop. This may seem interesting. I can see you guys smiling. But what happens in Africa when you're a 21-year-old, you've got HIV, you have no access to healthcare, your baby comes, you've never heard of an incubator, you can't afford oxygen? How many times is your baby going to die? This can't happen. So let me tell you what AXA has done. AXA took a premature baby, gave a lot of money. I'm now making sure that more premature babies 30 years from now can stand before an audience like this and be happy and healthy and enjoy Paris. I love Paris.
Thank you so much. I think you'll agree this training has clearly been fantastic and we have some amazing AXA Research Fund grantees. Wow, okay, so again, it's very clear that what you're working on is going to have big impacts from kind of the very small to much bigger. What I would like to know is how can insurers help support what you're doing more, okay? How can they support it? How can they overcome some of the problems? And what have we got to look forward to?
Okay, for me, this is a very important question because actually where I come from, insurance firms don't support premature deliveries. Whether you're rich, whether you're poor, the insurance will not cover prematurity. And this is an opportunity to show that it's a big issue in Africa because we have very high HIV prevalence rates. There's a high risk that you're going to be born premature. It's time for the insurance firms like AXA, thank you for investing in us, to invest in preterm deliveries. Actually, if my father didn't have a job, I wouldn't be here, you know? So it's time for insurance to admit that preterm is actually a big risk. And I think that it's, I'm very passionate about this matter.
I will say more or less the same. So I'm working on it's called neglected disease, so no one cares about it. And you know, thanks to AXA, we can have the opportunity to work on disease that are not interesting developing country, but it's actually, well, it's expanding all over the world, and if we have to obtain grant from the classical institution, we will not be able to have this money to do this kind of work.
Maybe just adding one thing, that I appreciate AXA supporting basic research, because my nanofibers will not be in the market in 3 months, maybe in 5 years. And many institutions that don't invest in basic research can make an impact, but not in a very, very short term, but in the midterm. And that's very important.
If you want to throw something in,
I was just going to add that, just like Nadia, in a way, most pandemics start in underdeveloped countries. So that's really a place where it's important. Preparedness is not an easy thing to get working locally. So working with people in those countries is probably the main way to get better preparedness for when problems start happening.
Thank you very much. Found them very inspiring and useful. Thank you, everybody. Give them a huge round of applause. Right. This is a mix of subjects in our third group of four. Cosmin's going to take us on a migration. Jean-Philippe's going to look at soil erosion. Divya's going to look at the plants that go in the soil. And Sophia's going to look at pollutants. So let's start. You're all here. You're all prepped. You're all ready. Over to you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Cosmin Corenda. I work for United Nations University in Bonn, Germany, and I'm a lawyer. Today, I'm going to present you very simplified my research on legal systems in the Pacific in regards to climate change. I'm aware focusing on three particular, if I get the thing, that would be perfect. Okay. We are focusing on three branches of international law: environmental law, human rights, and migration. And we are looking at how do they react in regards to climate change scenarios. So basically what is happening from the legal perspective, when you have a climate change scenario, then regardless if it's low onset, like sea level rise or drought, or if it's rapid onset, if like a storm or floods, the first effect will be a human rights violation. Some people in this world somewhere will get their rights violated. If you are referring, for example, to floods, if you have a house and your house is inundated, then you have the right to housing violated. If you have children who want to go to school and they can't do that because of the floods, then you have the right to education violated. So basically, it comes to the decision of the household. And the decision of the household, the decision of the household is actually reduced to only two options. They adapt and they stay in place, but if only if the state has the capacity to assist them, in particular because we are talking about developing countries. And secondly, the second option is to migrate. And the number of people who choose to migrate and not wait anymore for the help of the state, it's increasing by 30%. So in this regard, my research, which I'm conducting in the field in the Pacific Islands with the support and the partnership of AXA Research Fund, is trying to look at the legal systems which are existent in the Pacific now and to see how they influence the application of these legal approaches in regards to climate change scenarios. So we are looking at two systems because they are very particular in this regard, not like the rest or most of the world. They have two systems. They have the domestic system, which is like ours, like all of us, we're familiar with legislation and what is our legal system. But they also have a very strong customary law, traditional law, which is you can find it at the community level. And sometimes, like for example in Vanuatu, you have in the constitution that says that the custom always prevails, which means that the decisions of the chiefs, of the tribes, clans, and families, and other community organizations are actually much more favorable in front of the domestic law. These challenges could be very, very, very tricky, in particular when you are trying to help them externally with international law, like the Paris Agreement. If you want to implement in the Paris Agreement now in the Pacific Islands, you're going to just realize that it's very tricky because they don't necessarily work or complement. If you come from the national perspective, you have a tubular, top-down approach, and if you have it from the customary, you have a bottom-up approach, which is not necessarily reflected in the state's options. So this creates legal risk, implicitly climate risks, and this is actually what my research is trying to focus on. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, Jean-Philippe is next. So we will queue up the Prezi. That's what this program's called. It's called Prezi, not PowerPoint. You can take a photo and then move around it. Okay, I think we're all set. Over to you.
Hi, everyone. I am Jean-Philippe. I am a geoscientist, and I've been working over the last 2 years and a half in Canada. And now I'm going to work for the next 2 years in Germany. But I was French originally, so you can imagine how much I miss the food. And today, because I'm a geologist, probably you think I'm going to talk about rocks. No, actually, I'm going to talk about food. And my study is to look at the evolution of the soil erosion, because it is an issue for the soil, the food production. Probably you may know that today the human population is increasing a lot, and it has a big effect on the food demand. It is going to increase and to double over the next 50 years, which is a lot. So you need at this point to take care of what is producing the food. And do you know what is producing the food? Where it comes from? Actually, the main resources? Plants, things, no? It is soil. Because all the food is coming there, from the soil. So you want to protect these resources, and to protect them from what? Actually, with the human practices, we increase what we call the soil erosion. What is it? Basically, literally, you take some sediment, some particle from the soil, and you spread it away from the ocean, from reservoir, and so on. And you don't want, at the end, to come from a big, well-developed soil that is well that produces a lot to something like this that doesn't, you know, support the food production anymore. And at this point, probably you may want to know what is causing the soil erosion. Soil erosion, basically, it is caused by human activities, agriculture, deforestation, but also by climate change, like extreme events, like the flooding events that washed the soil away. And there is a big community that is working on soil erosion because it is a big challenge. But this community is working on modern data, on what is happening, you know, today. And we've got a very good idea of how it is going, and what is causing the soil erosion. But we don't know about the dynamic of the erosion. We don't know the rates of erosion. We don't know where, you know, in the world you've got hotspots, you know, of increasing rates of erosion, which is very challenging in some region, in very critical zones. So probably you don't know what this sketch represents, so I will tell you. It represents a map of the world, and yeah, hard to find. And during my project, the specificities is to collect data from all over the world, geological data, and to run them into models. And it is the first time we do this with a global network. And from some sites, I've been onto the field, like in Europe, in North America, to collect the samples. But the other samples coming from a big lab in the US, where we developed a collaboration, and they provided us some data from all over the world that they were securing in their facilities. So with all those data, for the first time, we are gonna reconstruct the dynamic of the soil erosion over the last 100, 200, 300 years, which is very well adapted, you know, to the evolution of the society. And at the end, the main objective is to reconstruct the hotspot of change, where it happens, to observe, you know, the cause of the change, and to learn from some experienced region, like in Europe. We have a very long history of human practices, deforestation, agriculture, but also management practices. And so this information can help us, you know, to transfer, you know, some technologies of experience, you know, in other countries where it is a very challenge today. And at the end, I would like to create a map of the risk at the global scale. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Okay, Divya next. So we'll just pull that up. Oh. Okay, over to you.
Thank you. So, good afternoon. I'm Divya. Jane highlighted the importance of soil. I'm going to dig a bit deeper that how soils can help us fighting climate change. So the key question before us is that can we reduce atmospheric levels of carbon dioxide? Is it possible that we can collect them and bury them into the ground? Well, let's have a look at nature. I'm talking about photosynthesis, the process with which we all are familiar with. Plants naturally absorb CO2 from air, and they convert it into their biomass, and they put it down into the soil because their roots go deep into the soil. And here where I'm interested, because when the carbon stabilizes in soil, it stays there for 100 to 1,000 years, for such a long time out of atmosphere, and this is what we call carbon sequestration. And scientists are very much enthusiastic about this process because if done correctly, it can help us removing up to 1.2 gigatons of carbon annually from the atmosphere. And you might be surprised to know that soils are actually the largest carbon reservoir on the land or terrestrial ecosystems. But the problem is that this very natural process is not so simple because there are some other things in the atmosphere. I'm talking about the air pollutants and particularly ozone. So why ozone? Because it is the most toxic air pollutant to plants. And what it does, it reduces photosynthesis. And what it means, less carbon is absorbed into the plant and therefore obviously less is going into the soil. And there are very strong hints that this effect is significant. And therefore, our ambition to use soil carbon sequestration to manage climate change mitigation is challenged. But we do not know how large this effect is or how large ozone poses the risk to this process. And this is what I'm doing with the AXA Research Fund. I'm conducting a modeling exercise for the first time by taking help of two very reliable and well-tested models, the DAWs for ozone effects on plants and Century that can model soil carbon dynamics. And by combining them, I'm estimating how much risk ozone pollution will have on soil carbon sequestration in the long term. And it is very important because we want to use our agricultural soils to help fighting climate change. It can buy us some time to deal correctly with climate change over the global scale. But for that, we also need to be sure that how confident we are in predicting how realistic our approach is. And it is possible only if we include all the factors that play together: air quality, climate change, plant, and soil. Because in nature, everything is connected to everything else, and to increase our confidence about such predictions or risk estimates, we need to combine everything together. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, so last in this batch, up it comes, Sophia. All set?
Yep.
All right, over to you.
Thank you. My name is Sophia Hansson. I'm Swedish, but I'm currently living and working in Toulouse. So merci à tous pour être là. I would like to briefly tell you about my project Blast from the Past, and more specifically, talk about legacy pollution. Now, when you hear the word pollution, most of us would think about factories, cars, airplanes, something connected to industrialization and modern times. But what if I tell you that in a lot of places of the world, some you can have a place far away from any factory, any road, any airport, say like a lake high up in the mountains. You go there, you hike, you fish, but it's actually highly polluted. That's the case of legacy pollutants. We're not even aware of them, but they're still there. You don't see them, but they still affect us. And when I mean legacy pollutants, what is that? Well, it's connected to historical mining and old mine sites, which also happens to be located in a lot of times in the mountains. And when I mean historical mining, we're talking about not just something that happened 100 years, maybe 500 years, or even thousands of years. So it has a long history, and because of that, it has also left a long-lasting impact on our environment. So what I do, together with my coworkers, with the support and in partnership with AXA, is that we're trying to study the effect of these legacy pollutants in today's environment. We're trying to make a risk assessment of how much of these pollutants, like lead and mercury, plomb, mercure, how much of that is going to affect today's society, not just the health of the environment, such as fish, but also the fishermen eating the fish. And in the next step, also the quality of our drinking water, because most of our drinking water is actually coming from the mountains. So what we do is that we go up in the mountains, in my case, it's the French Pyrenees. Gorgeous place. If you've never been there, go. It's the cheese is also amazing, even in French standard. So we go there, we collect samples of soil, of fish, water, etc. We bring it back to the lab and we analyze it. And why is this important? And the thing is, think about legacy pollution as an environmental sin that we've inherited from our ancestors. So we may not have caused the problem, but it is our problem to fix. So with that, I'd say thank you.
Thank you very much. Please stay up here if the other three could come and join. Okay. Now, I don't want to lower the tone and get all serious, but these are very big problems. Okay, we're talking about climate change, we're talking about legacy pollution affecting drinking water and other problems, right? We're talking about issues with pollutants in the air, we're talking about plants not being able to take up the carbon, like these are big issues. So I suppose I'm looking for a ray of hope, but also a realistic opinion of, can we defeat these problems? Can we slowly chip away at them? Or, you know, what's the timeline on this sort of thing?
In terms of the legacy pollutants, I would say yes, because what we're starting to see is that some of it, a lot of it has been stored in the soils for already 500 years maybe. The problem is that what we need to assess is what is going to happen in climate change. If you have increased precipitation, increased soil erosion and everything that we had, it's not just the ozone, but are these metals going to come with it? And so far we see that they're stored in organically rich soils like wetlands, peatlands. And if we can find out the way how it's actually bound to it, then we can use that in other environments and then try to keep it from actually entering our waters and in that sense protecting it. So with the legacy pollutants, we are already at the point where we can prevent before it actually becomes a really urgent problem, but we need to act quickly.
And what about soil erosion? Clearly it looks like it's going to have a big impact. Are we going to be able to do something about it?
With soil erosion, it's a little bit different because to produce 1 centimeter of soil, it takes probably thousands of years. So if you eroded, you know, in a few decades, so it takes the time to fix it. So in some place, you can reduce, you know, the risk of erosion. You want actually to act before you have to fix it. Yeah, this is the basic idea. And in some place, it's a little bit late. In some other, we need to do it now to make the good practices.
It's as the ancient Greek says, prevention before cure, right? We need to get on this as soon as possible. And thank goodness we have researchers like you doing this work supported by AXA Research Fund to be looking at this before it becomes a real, real problem. Give these four a huge round of applause. Thank you so much. Okay, so we're on to our final group of four now. All of these ones are socioeconomic risks. Carol is going to be protecting our power supply. Dionne is introducing us to new instruments. Philip is to new models. And last but not least, Fulio is going to be at the intersection of politics and economics. So are we ready to dive into these? Are you all set?
Sure.
Okay.
Sorry.
This is for you.
Thank you.
Okay, Carol, you're up first.
Okay. So, my name is Karol Dworzyniak, and I would like to talk to you about protecting the power supply with better risk management. So, electricity constitutes a very important factor of our lives, especially if we take into account the critical infrastructure. It's difficult to imagine that, for example, power is not supplied continuously to these objects. And how the security is currently measured? Operators, transmission system operators, they use very naive measure, if I can say like that. So they use so-called N-1 principle. What it means? Let me do this on an example. Let me assume that we constitute the power system. So I'm, for example, the generator. You are the branch generator, load, and so on. And then N-1 principle means that if I lose one of you, no matter which one, the system still survives. So parameters are kept in the limits. So then we have binary measure. Your system is secure or it's not secure. Only two options. Is this really enough? Maybe it is not always needed to be kept, this N-1 principle. For example, if we have France and then we relax this N-1 principle, as a result, we lost, for example, the Paris and surroundings, then for sure we shouldn't do this. But in the second case, if we maybe have a risk for a small village somewhere there for 15 minutes, then if the cost is very, very high, maybe it's good to just accept this risk. And another question, is this N-1 principle always enough? So if it is fulfilled, the system is secure. Probably no. If we can imagine, for example, very severe weather conditions around us, then the probability that we lose two of us is considerably high. So we need something different than this measure. So this is our first invention, that we offered the continuous risk measure. We are able to predict the risk in hours ahead using this measure. And second point, what if system is not secured? What if this principle is currently not fulfilled? Then the operators have to apply so-called remedial actions. So basically, they shift the generation from one country, from one part of the country to another part. So you can imagine the cost of this action. And they do this as soon as possible. So if we have this continuous risk measure, then we can pay attention not only to the time, but we can pay attention to the time and money, and we can optimize both. So this research is not only about developing the theory. We would like to provide the application, the tool for the operators to just keep the system more secure. We've done the prototype. It will be my pleasure to show it to you later if you are interested. We have clients that are potentially interested into this product. We have the team. Thankfully to AXA, we have also the money for the first phase to just go through the research phase. And what we are missing still is the networking between our group and between potential clients. And I think that AXA can potentially help here. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. All right, DNA up next. So we'll just pull this one up. Okay. All set, sir? Yep.
Yeah.
Over to you.
Well, hello, everyone. My name is Dionisio Pérez. I am Spanish economist and frustrated painter as well. I'm standing here in front of you today because we are mismanaging our most precious resource on Earth, water. As a result of that, the number of droughts and the scarcity that we are suffering in many regions is aggravating. Here, you can see the conventional way of managing water resources right now, water-related problems. A very self-confident policymaker thinks that he has found a silver bullet, and he is just shooting it. He's trying to solve the problem with this cure-for-all solution that allegedly will end up all the water-related problems once and for all, everywhere, at any time. The problem with silver bullets is that they often do not deliver what they promise, and they can backfire on the environment and on society as a whole. The goal of my research is to explore what policy or combination of policies can address water-related problems now and in the future. So I take a look at different alternatives, including pricing, trading, irrigation restrictions, and also insurance, and other policies that can potentially help, individually or together in a policy mix. How do I do that? I rely on an ensemble or combination of models. The first one in which I'm working right now is a clockwork water user. We try to reproduce the behavior of agents in real life using a virtual model. And this way, we are able to ask them how they will react to specific policies and combination of policies. Once we know that, we can take a look at what will happen to the local communities and the environment as well, at national level and at a supranational level. With these two informations, we know what is going on economy-wide, and therefore we know what are the implications that this has in turn for the farm business. This research is able to give us some insights on how to align individual decisions with collectively agreed goals for water policy, and can help us to manage in a very cost-effective to maximize the welfare of the water users, the environment, and the society as well. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Some great drawings again there. I'm loving your artistic work. As you say, failed artist or failed painter, I don't think so. Okay, so we'll just pull this one up. Oh, no, not that one.
Unfortunately, that's not mine.
I mean, you could try. It'd be an interesting exercise. Okay, over to you.
All right, so thank you very much. So my name is Philip Eisenhower, and I'm an economist that works on strategies to cope and confront uncertainties. So anyone remember the recent financial crisis? That's probably a clear yes. So as it turns out, one of the reasons that were identified in causing this crisis was the reliance on so-called risk assessment models that informed decisions that in the end led to a lot of risky investment and high leverage ratios on the part of, for example, financial intermediaries. And then we were all surprised when these models turned out to be wrong and a lot of actors found themselves unable to meet their financial obligations. So the takeaway here is that decisions that make perfect sense in one particular setting then can have horrendous consequences when the scenario or the world actually turns out to be different. So what I'm working on is what is so-called robust decisions. Those are decisions that work well over a whole range of different scenarios. And that's in contrast with the standard approach in economics, which studies optimal decisions. Okay, these are decisions that work best, but only for one particular scenario. Okay, so let me just try to drive home this point with a little graphical illustration here. So on the vertical axis, we have profits. The more, the better. On the horizontal axis, there's surprise, or the element of surprise. The more, the worse. And what I have here is the profits that correspond, or the payoffs corresponding to alternative decision rules, optimal and robust for alternative elements of surprise. So as you see, if there is no element of surprise, if we're on the vertical axis, then of course the optimal decision rule actually, you know, has the highest rewards. But while if we're surprised by the state of the world in the end, then it's not good for both types of decision rules. But as you see, for the robust decisions, the consequences are much less severe. So what is it? What's the best way to go? Robust or optimal decisions? I don't know about you guys, but myself, I find myself surprised a lot in a variety of settings. These include financial decisions, but also career choices, for example. So as it turns out, with my current focus, where I'm modeling educational careers, if you actually analyze observed educational decisions to enroll in high school, to pursue a higher degree, under the lens of robust decision making, you're much better able to explain the observed patterns in the data. So more on that next time, because in the end, it actually comes down to this. It's better to be vaguely right than exactly wrong. So at least sometimes. And well, thank you very much for your support in fleshing out this basic insight in a little bit more detail. So thanks.
Thank you, Philip. Great stuff. Okay, our final speaker is Fulia, so we'll pull this one up.
Thank you very much.
It's over to you.
Good morning. My name is Fulia Paydan. I'm of Turkish origin, but I work in Barcelona. I'm a political scientist by training. And today I want to talk about whether we can use a moral shield for black swans. I'm not going to be talking about the bird. I'm going to be talking about highly rare outlier events that are totally unseen. And my project investigates, for instance, 2008 crisis was a black swan event. So my project investigates whether moral belief systems, ethical values, or religious teachings have any slowdown effect on slowing down the negative impact of these unforeseen events. So as you all know, and my colleague Philip just mentioned a while ago, 2008 was an unforgettable year for many of us. Individuals were affected, profits went down for many of the businesses, the individual debt levels went up. I live in Spain, a lot of people were unable to pay their mortgages. They were kicked out of their homes. And one reason why this happened is the way our financial system works. As we all know, conventional banks, financial institutions, they charge interest. There's a lot of speculation going on. And obviously, they work under regulators, and this regulations, as we know it, were supposed to be the silver bullet, the one-size-fits-all solution to avoid these events. But in this particular case, it didn't happen. But while this part of the world was experiencing a lot of difficulties, elsewhere across the globe, other financial institutions have seen an increase in their profit levels. And these are precisely what I'm looking at. These are Islamic banks, Islamic financial institutions. And in this particular case, these two components, interest and speculation, they are absolute no-no. They do not work with these, and the 2008 performance of these banks were quite high, and the individuals who were working with these banks did not necessarily experience the same thing as their Spanish counterparts did. And this was possible partially because these informal, unwritten limitations derived from the Islamic religious teachings acted also as a slowdown effect These moral restrictions are very important, and what my research finds so far is formal regulations, together with informal regulations, these could be inspired by religious teachings, they could be customs, they could be local traditions, they induce a controlled risk-taking behavior. Maybe, but this is a strong maybe, we can actually kick the black swans out if we pay attention to informal regulations as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, let's have you three join me. So just a quick question for all of you, really, until we get on to the final half of the session. And that is, again, huge, wide-reaching impacts. You've obviously raised the 2008 massive issues. What I want to know is, all your research, is it going to change the way that we make investments in the future? Do you think we're going to regain trust and we're going to behave differently from what your research is showing us?
Well, that's of course going to depend on the quality of my research, but it's at least an ambition in the sense that we acknowledge the trade-off that different, in my case, economic models imply for the risk that is associated with certain strategies.
Anybody else like to contribute to that one?
Yeah, maybe not talking about the trust. I think that our research can generate further opportunities for business. So that's also an important thing. I don't think that trust can be recovered so easily. But in the end, if we manage to create business opportunities that not only benefit those that are directly interested in them, but also society and the environment, I mean, that can contribute maybe a lot to that goal.
Well, thank you very much for very, very interesting talks. Give them a huge round of applause as they go back to their seats. Thank you, guys. Okay, so that completes all of the presentations. So it means that now, you'll be very pleased to know, we're about to have sandwiches. Yes. But then what we're going to have is our World Cafe event. Now, to explain what's going to happen then, there are going to be sandwiches outside. Then the researchers are going to go two on each table, all right? And they're going to have their placemat with them, their set de table with them. And then we'd like to invite all the rest of you to go round and sit with them and ask them some of the questions that you've been sketching down on the pieces of paper. You're going to have 10 minutes at a table. So that's about 5 minutes with each of the grantees to ask them those questions, to have one-on-one or two or three-on-one and just have a nice casual conversation and get to know them and get to know their research a little bit more. We're going to do that until 1 o'clock and then there's going to be a cocktail outside. So can we please just put our hands together for all of the presentations and show them our support? I was really impressed by the quality of that communication. It was absolutely superb. Some fantastic drawings, some lovely stories, some very nice explanations. So I look forward to going around and hearing a little bit more about them with you. Here comes the service. Look at this. So what I would like to ask then is the grantees to stand up, grab your placemats and move so there are two of you on each table. AXA employees, if you could also stand up, please, as well. Maybe put your stuff to one side, grab your question cards, and then go and join some of the grantees at their table. And this will be us for the next 45 minutes.